pense que c'est.
Okay, so welcome back for the second day. I'm very pleased to introduce Damien Garcia, who has been working in Montreal for quite some time, and he's now in Lyon in CREATIS. So he's going to talk to us about flow, and later we'll have a talk about deformation. So let's say that in the general progression of the Winterschool, we talked yesterday a lot about acquisition. And now we want to see what's behind the acquisition and the image itself, and what we can retrieve in terms of cardiac function, which is we want to get access to the flow and the deformation, which are the two main axes. Odile would agree with me that you have the pressure against the volume, so it's the deformation against the flow. So today we'll look at these two axes, and we start with the flow. So okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, first, hello everyone, and thank you, Mathieu, for this invitation. It was very, it's a great opportunity for me to present here. Yesterday, you had a brief introduction on ultrasound imaging. Today, I'm going to talk about Doppler. Card Doppler is the way to measure blood velocity using ultrasound imaging, but I won't talk about the techniques. I just want to talk about some applications. I think that, Yann, I don't know if you want to, if you will talk about the basic of Doppler. For those who do not know, Yann is the tallest guy in the ultrasound meeting. And probably we talk about Doppler, well, I mean the technique. So first I will do a very brief introduction on Doppler, very brief one, for you to know the basic concepts. And then I'm going to talk about two clinical applications. Well, I was indeed an associate professor at the University of Montreal for 7 years. I was living in Montreal for almost 20 years. And then for many reasons, I had to come back to France. And now I'm an innovative researcher in CREATIS in Lyon, so working with Olivier and his colleagues. And I'm also, for the moment, a clinical researcher. So I'm working with cardiologists at the Croix-Rousse Hospital. Well, this is a typical image that you can see in the clinical practice. This is Card Doppler. You can see the BMOD image on the background. So the grayscale image that Olivier talked about yesterday. And today we talk about this feature. So this is Card Doppler. Card Doppler typically is red and blue. And it represents the blood flow. Here, this is inside the left ventricle. You have here the left ventricle. The mitral leaflet is here. You can see the leaflets here, and the left atrium. So while in red, you can see filling of the heart. So we talk about this approach. There is also a way. In my presentation, I will do some quantification from Card Doppler. There is a way also to do some quantification with ultra-fast imaging. This is an example. I won't talk about this, but this is I just wanted to show you what we can do also with ultra-fast ultrasound. Mathieu Pernot yesterday talked about this. So this, for example, imaging, and of course with vector flow imaging, if you have a representation of the flow here, this is in the left in the carotid. Of course, you can extract some data. But I won't talk about this technique. I will use for this presentation the standard clinical scanner. So it won't be the ultra-fast mode. It will be the classical way to do ultrasound imaging using focused transmit. And it will be also on echocardiography. Echocardiography, this is the ultrasound imaging of the heart. And we focus on the left ventricle, which is the main chamber, the chamber where the pressure is the highest in the heart, and this is a typical scanning here. So of course you have a patient, and this is a phased array probe, phased array transducer, and if you want a view, this is the apical view. You can have a long axis view in the heart, so you can, for example, this is the location of the probe. Is at the apical location here. It is an apical location. And in this view, you can have a slice along the long axis. Well, there are many views. This one, we can have the type of movie that I said before. And mostly, I'm working with this long axis view. this is what we saw yesterday. This is the focus transmit. So to create an image, we have to transmit many times. So we have, for each acquisition, we can create a scan line. So you can imagine that to create one image, we need, well, let's say around 50 scan lines to create one image. So to create one image with a conventional ultrasound, in cardiac imaging, we will need 50 transmits like this. But for Doppler, it's a bit more complicated. We see whether we need more transmits. I will show you this later. So this is the brief outline of our presentation. First, we need some very basic fundamentals of card Doppler. And then we talk about two applications. This is intraventricular pressure difference. So how can we extract the difference of pressure between the apex and the mitral annulus using card Doppler? And then I will talk about intraventricular vector flow mapping. So using card Doppler, how to reconstruct the velocity vector field in the left ventricle. So first, the Doppler effect. Well, this is the classical example. When the noise source, it was the slide that I used last year, so I have to upgrade, sorry. So this is a typical example for the Doppler effect that everyone knows. When the noise source is moving away, so you have some kind of lower frequency, and then the noise source is approaching, it seems that the frequency is higher. Well, actually, it was discovered by Christian Doppler, and this guy was working in the binary stars, and he observed that the frequency of a wave, of course, depends on the relative speed between the source and the observer. And from this, he wanted to explain why he observed a shift in the light spectrum with the binary stars. So, for example, when the star is approaching, you observe a red shift like this. So here you have the light absorption, and when the star is moving away, you have a shift toward the blue lines. So you can see, for example, this one and this one, you have a shift. So this is the Doppler effect, and it was discovered for this application. Of course, you have other applications for Doppler effect. It is used for weather. So with Doppler radar, you can have an estimate of the speed of the wind. It has also been used for the detection of exoplanets. And of course, everyone almost can know this application for license suspension. And also, Doppler effect has been used also to explain and to quantify the expansion of universe. But it won't be our topic. Our topic will be this one. So we talk about Doppler echocardiography. There are several modes for Doppler echocardiography. Here we have some example. This is here the pulse wave Doppler in the carotid. Here you have two examples. You have the color Doppler, the red and blue. So this is color. And with the spectral Doppler, we won't talk about this, but you can have, for example, the velocity as a function of time. Here, this is the velocity as a function of time, the blood velocity in this sample volume that you can see here. So you can see the pulsatile flow. Here, this is an application for color Doppler. So this color Doppler is mostly a visualization tool. In this case, you can see, for example, the clinician can detect this is a leak between the two ventricles. So this is a shunt, we call this a shunt. And there is kind of hole between the left ventricle and the right ventricle. So using color Doppler is very visible. Now, how to quantify it, it's a question, but actually, using card Doppler, it is very visible. You have also other applications, like this is the same application as this one, but here this is for the left ventricle. This is the blood velocity at the level of the mitral leaflet, the mitral valve, so between the left atrium and the left ventricle. And you can see that here, we talk about this later, you can see that there is two phases during the filling, because first we have the left ventricular relaxation and then the atrial contraction. So there are two phases during the diastole. We talk about this later. And there is another mode. This is continuous wave Doppler, where we can have the velocity along the scan line. So in this case, that's why the spectrum is broad. For a given time, you have all the it represents all the velocity along this line. So I don't talk about this one. So I prefer today we focus on color Doppler. Yes. This is what I will explain later. You will see that this is only a projection. So this line. So I will explain you, because that's a very important point. So we have three modes in clinics. There is continuous wave Doppler and pulse wave Doppler. Both these modes are called spectral Doppler. It was the first application of Doppler in the clinics when it was discovered, when it was developed for the clinicians. But now there is also color Doppler. This is an example in the carotid bifurcation. And so today, we focus on color Doppler, but in the left ventricle. So what is, the question, what is the Doppler velocity? The Doppler velocity is only the projection of the blood velocity along the propagation axis of the ultrasonic wave. So imagine that the actual velocity vector is this one, the blood velocity. So if your beam axis is this one, both in transmission and in reception, so the color Doppler will give the projection of this vector. So Doppler velocity is this one. Okay, so you only have one component. Even if the velocity field is three-dimensional, even if you have three components, color Doppler will give only the projection along the beam axis. And of course, the amplitude will depend upon the angle. So here, this is the same representation. And if you have a blood flow in an artery, color Doppler will give the projection, and it will also depend on the frequency, because you remember the effect, the frequency shift and the link between the velocity. But what is important is that you have the projection here. So in practice, in the artery, you can correct for the angle. If you know, of course, the angle, and if you know more or less the direction of the blood velocities of the blood flow, so you can correct and obtain the actual velocity. So remember, this is only the projection. It will be important for another application. And while the conventionally, I think for the reason, for the blood blood color in the artery versus in the vein, well, this is the conventional color, so this is red and blue. And red, this is when the blood flows toward the probe, yes. And blue, this is when it moves away from the probe. So when this is typical color map for color Doppler. Of course, there are many others, but mostly it's only this one. And this is an example. So in blue, in red, this is when the blood flows to the probe. The probe is at this location. First, I have to explain. This is a left ventricle. If you are not familiar with echocardiography, this is an image of the left ventricle. Here you have the left ventricle, like this. Here, this is the left atrium. Here are the mitral leaflets and the aorta. In the B mode, if you have a nice quality, you can see pretty well the myocardium of the left ventricle, the left atrium, and the aorta. You can see the comparison is very similar. And here, if we had the color Doppler mode, so you can have an idea of the flow in the left ventricle. So when it's red, it means that the flow goes to to other probe, and then it goes away in blue. So you can see, you can have an idea of the filling and then on the ejection. Blue, it will be the ejection, and the red, the filling. Remember, this is a way to generate a B-mode, so scanline by scanline, like this. And for Doppler, this is not, since you need the information over time, you have to transmit many times at a given location. Here, there is only three scan lines, but in practice, of course, you have around 40, well, 30, 40, 50, depending on the sector. But typically, you have to transmit 8 to 60 times to give information to obtain information over time, and then to obtain the to deduce the phase shift and then the frequency shift. So in practice, since you have, remember, you have to do many scan lines, and then in this case you have to transmit many times for a given scan lines, so the frame rate is only 10, in practice, I will say it is only 10 frames per second. So this is very quite low, and that's why there's so many investigations in ultra-fast color Doppler in the left ventricle. Also, there is another mode that I will talk about later, the color M mode. In this case, this is the same as previously, but along one scan line. In this case, we're tracing only along one scan line. So in this case, we can have a high temporal resolution because we don't need to sweep on the sector. And here we have only one scan line. So along this scan line, we have the velocity. For example, on this scan line here, this is for a given time, you have the velocity from the apex at the top to the base. So in this case, you can have a very good temporal and spatial resolution of the Doppler velocity over time. Is it okay for this? No? You understand this one? Okay, so on the top, you have the typical B-mode image, okay? Then you want to do some color Doppler. You want to obtain the Doppler velocity, which is the projection of the blood velocity, along, but not, you don't want it in the in 2D. You want it only along one scan line, along one line. Here, this is a representation of Doppler velocity along this line. So let's say from the apex here to the base here, as a function of time. So for a given time, let's say here, for a given time here, you have the Doppler velocity everywhere in this line.
Okay, so why is why X is this special location?
Why?
Why
using this?
No, the Y
axis. Ah, okay, sorry. Here, this is the depth. So, yeah, this is the depth. This is from 0 centimeter to 15 centimeter. So from the top of the scan line to the, okay. And using this technique, so we'll be able to deduce the intraventricular pressure difference. This is what I'm going to explain here. So again, this is a clinical study. So we use a conventional ultrasound. And even for this application, we did not use a Philips, but a G scanner. I'm sorry about that, but it was a way for me to extract the data before scan conversion. And the topic is to obtain a better estimation of the diastolic function. Diastolic function is very important. Diastole is this is the ventricular filling. So you have to, mostly you have systole. This is when you have the ejection, and diastole when you have the filling of the left ventricle. And during the diastole, you have two phases. First, the ventricular relaxation. This is when the left ventricle relaxes. And then you have the second phase, the atrial contraction. Here, the left atrium, there is a contraction to finish the diastole. That's why if you look at the velocity in the mitral valve, you will have two phases like this. So first, the E wave, and then the A wave, which is related to the early filling, to the ventricular relaxation, and then to the atrial contraction. And actually, it is very difficult to estimate in some patients the diastolic dysfunction. You have many parameters based on the tissue Doppler, so based on the tissue, but the velocity of the tissue, for example, at this location, You have other parameters depending on the blood velocity in the mitral valve, but sometimes you have some contradiction. So estimating the assessment of the acid dysfunction is still an important point for the clinician. You have several ways, as I told you. So if you use the pulse width Doppler, you can have an estimate of the blood velocity at the level of the mitral leaflet. Here, this is a normal case. You have the two phases with the E wave and A wave. And here you can see that the E peak is lower than the A1, and it denotes a problem in the diastasis function. So in this case, it could be very clear. But sometimes you have normal patients with this pattern. There is also another way to estimate for in clinics. You have also tissue Doppler. Tissue Doppler, Yang will talk about this for the next presentation. This is, you also want the velocity, but not of the blood, but of the tissue. So here, this is, it represents the velocity of the tissue at the level of the mitral leaflets here. And you can see, again, the two peaks. It's the same as, similar, right? It's the same pattern. And here, you can see that the E prime is lower than the A prime. So it can also reflect a problem in the diastole. We have other parameter. Well, you can also investigate the flow in the pulmonary vein here, and also there is using color mode. It's something that many investigators tried a few years ago. This is the I won't talk about this, but it's from color Doppler. You can have an estimate of the propagation velocity, but the parameter was not reproducible, so it has been it has never been used in clinics, only in research. And now this is a parameter which is not used anymore because the reproducibility is very poor. So how to estimate the how to obtain an estimate of the diastolic function? It will be the topic. This is how the myocardial dynamics looks like. You have during the contraction and during relaxation, you have distortion. Remember the fiber yesterday described by the fiber organization described by Mathieu. So with this organization, when you have the contraction and the relaxation, you have this kind of torsion. Here, this is a slice of the left ventricle, and here a slice of the right ventricle. By the way, you can see that there is a big difference, a large difference between the geometry of the right and the left ventricle. So remember distortion. And from distortion, some clinicians and some researchers has proposed a parameter to describe distortion and this detortion. So this is during ejection, you have the twist, so ejection twist, and then the feeling, so you have untwist or in the opposite direction. And if you have a look at the rotation at the base, here this is the base and here the apex. So you can have the rotation over time. You can see here the blue, this is for the apex, and the red one is for the base. And if you have the difference, so you have this the left ventricular twist. And this parameter has been proposed a few years ago to describe the diastolic diastolic function. So for example, how to do that? So you can do a B mode, a cross section, B mode at the base level, another one at the apical level, and then using speckle tracking. So you have speckle tracking. Again, it will be the topic. Jan, I think we'll talk again, about speckle tracking in the next presentation. And using speckle tracking, so you can have an idea of the displacement, and then for this example, you can extract the angle over time. And using the difference between the base and the apex, you can have an idea of the left ventricular twist. This is this one is the difference, and this is the blue minus the red one, so you have this one. And the velocity of this rotation, so the untwisting rate, the twisting rate, and we are for during diastole, you have rapid relaxation, and some investigators were interested in this peak untwisting rate. And they actually showed that this peak untwisting rate has been introduced as a clinical marker of early diastolic function. And they said that it is, this is an example, and this is, it has been published, this one in JACC Imaging. So they said that the left ventricular untwisting rate is an important parameter for early diastolic function. This is one example, but there are many clinical papers. But the problem is that speckle tracking is very difficult in this application, because it can be very suboptimal at the base. And thus, even this parameter could be very interesting. They observe a high variability from one operator to the next one. So we saw that this peak untwisting rate is an important clinical marker for the diastolic function. It even might be the best one according to the researcher who wrote the papers, but it is poorly reproducible. And then probably we observe many problems with CHUM imaging, and probably we could have the same problem. It is not really applicable for the clinical routine. So the objective now was to propose a surrogate marker for this peak untwisting rate. So the solution maybe is in the flow, because we mainly focus on the tissue, but we could focus on the blood flow. So it's clear that for any pump, you have a strong link between the pump power and the fluid pressure. Here, this is a simulation. Of course, it's clear, it's obvious that the dynamics of the pump. I prefer to say that the blood flow or the fluid dynamics within a pump is linked to the dynamics of the pump. So the hypothesis was the intraventricular pressure gradient, so the difference of pressure. If you want a flow, you need a pressure difference. So we hypothesized that the pressure difference in the left ventricle, it might be linked to the pump. In this case, to the untwisting rate. What we need, if we need a pressure difference, we need the velocity. And remember that the color M mode with Doppler, we can have some estimation of the blood velocities. So maybe using this equation, you can have something interesting. This is a Bernoulli equation. So we have a Bernoulli equation. This is the relationship between the velocity and the pressure. And there are some hypotheses here, but this is a very basic equation in fluid dynamics. And you see that if you know the velocity from point 1 to point 2 along a streamline, you could have everything. So if you know the velocity in V1, V2, and also here this is the acceleration along this line, so we could have the difference P1 minus P2 here. We can have the difference of pressure. So if we know the velocity again, V2 and V1, and plus the acceleration over time, so we could have some idea of the pressure difference. It's clear? Yeah. Ah, it was CFD, computational fluid dynamics. That's why it's very nice. This one, yes. It was a simulation in fluid dynamics. Yes.
So that model you are taking along the segment.
Yes.
But what about the difference of pressure?
Exactly.
In the other directions.
This is a good example. This is a good question. We assume that using this equation, that the flow is mostly in this direction. In this case, it will be neglected, and of course. Well, this technique was tested, it was compared with catheter, so with real pressure measurements in animals and even in patients. And using the technique, they showed that they were able to predict the pressure difference very well. So the assumption that the flow is along the streamline is not that bad.
Related to that question, there is a vortex inside the ventricle when you are feeling.
Does the position of the long axis
exactly.
The way,
I will talk about the vortices later. But in our case, we're interested during the early filling. So this, you have a strong jet, and then you have the vortex formation. So this is, well, of course, this is a very specific instant. So this is when you have a strong jet, so it's almost linear, almost, and depending, of course, of the geometry. And then you have the vortex formation, and this won't be enough. It won't work anymore. This is very specific at the E wave, at the peak. So it would be, I don't know if you can see something here. Maybe you can imagine at the beginning you have a strong jet, so it's almost, more or less, it's almost linear. At the very beginning, you can see here. And then you have a vortex formation. So we need to extract the pressure difference, we need the velocities. And since we want the velocity with the high temporal resolution, because we need the acceleration. And we will need this only along a scanline, so color mode. Well, this is, it would be the modality of choice for this approach. So here again, we along this line, you have the velocities all along this line as a function of time. No, you're not sure. You're
no, I'm not sure.
Okay. Not about this. Okay. So again. You have the velocities here. This is the raw. Well, this is the images given by the scanner. If we extract the data, then you can post-process them and use. You can do some post-processing, and we need the acceleration. So it will be here the acceleration over time. And so we have the velocity here. Okay. We're interested in the velocity at the micro leaflet. The one at the apex, this is a difference, but the one at the apex is very small, almost zero. And then you have the acceleration components, and integrating this acceleration over the scan line. So you have two components: the component linked to kinetic energy, and the one to the inertial component. And then you can have the difference of pressure over time, but we want this one, so we want the peak to be sure that this is we have this linear, the good linear assumption. So using this technique, we measure the peak pressure difference during diastole, and we test this. We try this in 150 patients, and they all have a normal systolic function, but they had a large range of diastolic function induced by the age, hypertension, etc. We use a clinical scanner, so it was in this case a Vivid 7 or E9. Then with the EcoPack software, we were able to extract the data, so the data before scan conversion. And now we have a question.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Yeah. I think I missed it, but between which and which point exactly do you measure the
pressure
difference?
It was between the apex and the base.
All right, so it's only left ventricle.
So the apex here.
Okay, because sometimes your segment goes way down in the atrium, but it's to the base. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. So between the base, and it was at the level of the mitral annulus here. And then while we're using the technique, we extract the peak pressure difference using color mode, and also the peak untwisting rate, so using B-mode spectral tracking as a reference. So we first observed that the peak untwisting rate was poorly reproducible, because I remember to obtain this distortion, we need to do spectral tracking using two cross sections, but it was very poorly reproducible, and we even had to reject patients. So at the beginning, we almost had 200 patients, but we had to reject around 50 patients not because of the color mode, but because of the spectral tracking. On the other side, we saw that the peak pressure difference, it was highly reproducible. So maybe it could be a good technique. And here, this is the correlation that we observe in these patients between the diastolic pressure difference and the untwisting rate. So under the hypothesis that the distortion rate is linked to a diastolic function, and since we observe a very nice correlation, it seems that the peak pressure difference could be, it is very reproducible, and also it could be a marker for diastolic dysfunction. So when this is what you observe, this paper is not true. It is not under review. because you will see Amir later, and he was supposed to submit last week, but probably it will be next week. So it's not really true. It's not under review. Soon under review, I would say. Yes?
Question about reproducibility.
Yes.
So how did you check that? Was it with multiple acquisition or
multiple acquisition
readings?
And multiple operator during the post-processing.
Okay. So even between acquisition?
Yes. Yes. Because a color mode is, you have to align. It's difficult to say because it is in the same group. So probably they have the same habit. So this is not a multi-center study. Of course, if we want to check the real reproducibility, this is something that should be checked between different centers. Because for strain imaging in the same group, it is well reproducible, I would say. But from a center to another one, with another scanner to another one, you can have some significant differences. Yes? Oh, sorry. This is for recording, yes.
Is there a big difference between inter-op reproducibility, meaning that somebody who knows the device, who knows the technique, is
probably yes. Of course, the cardiologists who use this approach, they use it. They have some time to practice. The software is. Everything is fully automatic. De-aliasing is automatic, smoothing is automatic. There is no fine-tuning in the smoothing parameter. I think the main point is to select the dislocation, so the mitral. This is the source of errors between one operator and the next one. And since it was in the same group, they all use almost the same. Of course, they practice together. So probably this is a bias for this approach.
Sorry. Could you explain why you needed this smooth step?
Because we need a time. Here we need the derivative of a time. This we need the acceleration. Where is it? Where is the pointer? We need the acceleration. Well, for this picture, it is over smooth, and it's just for visualization. Because I don't know why, but this presentation was first from my cardiologist colleagues, and they like very smooth images. So I have to over smooth for this presentation, but in the software, this is not as smooth as this. But it's smooth enough, this is automatic, to have a good estimate of the acceleration.
Why did you choose untwisting rate and not, for example, longitudinal strain rate to compare with?
Why? Because, that's a good question. We try everything, E prime, the ratio E prime over E, A over A, the typical parameter. So
you're looking at the pressure gradient, so you look at the deformation gradient.
Yes.
So strain rate would be the most obvious.
We try it. Of course, it will be in the publication, and we didn't see any. The correlation was lower.
But that's quite strange because the twisting is caused by the longitudinal deformation.
But which parameter will you measure? It could be the A prime or.
No, strain rate.
Strain rate. Well, it is very. They didn't test it because it's very noisy.
Your pressure gradient is as noisy, so...
No, pressure gradient is much less noisy than strain rate. And
because when you look at it, the twisting...
Yes.
Well, still a lot of cardiologists believe it's important. I think it's totally unimportant. If you look at publications from Maastricht on patients with situs inversus,
yes,
they have no twisting, and they still have normal pressure gradients, normal cardiac function. So the twisting is... of deformation and the fiber orientation.
Yes.
So to me, the more logical would be is to go to a deformation gradient. And as you say, it's difficult to measure. It might be that this is a much better way to assess this. So I do agree on that one.
Okay, so it would be the next topic with the topic of our next project. Well, probably you know a strain rate very well, and it's not that easy to have
It's still easier than twisting.
Okay, maybe. This maybe depends on the centers. Strain rate. So we didn't. We use strain imaging, but not strain rate here. This is what was talking about. And okay, so in this case, it could be. This is something that we should investigate later because for in our patients, I don't know why. It's something that I could. We'll meet the cardiologist this afternoon. it would be a good question. Why they focus on this only on the rotation and not on the strain rate imaging? And strain rate, well, it will be described by Jan later. So you, okay. No, you can estimate strain rate from tissue Doppler, or from or also from spectral tracking. Okay. So it will Jan will discuss about this later. So you have two techniques, and depending on well, there are both advantage and drawbacks. And this is what Jan will talk about later: strain imaging and strain rate imaging.
So. One question. So, if what is the correlation, or probably related with the ejection fraction?
No, the ejection fraction was normal in this case. The systolic function was normal.
Oh yeah.
Almost. Well.
But even
well, according to the ejection fraction, this is not the best parameter. But well, at least the ejection.
It was normal.
Yes. But this is not the parameter for systolic function.
I have just one quick question. Could you go back to the curve of pressure?
This one?
No, I would like to know the scale of pressure.
This is from 2 to, well, in this case, to 7 millimeter of mercury. Okay. Yes. And also, there
it's
is.
Important to.
Okay. During systole, also for the during the ejection, you can have also. In normal subject, you have a difference around 6 millimeter of mercury as well, in normal subjects.
Could you comment on your hypothesis on the untwisting and the, I mean, how is related the untwisting with the pressure gradient? It's not clear.
Well, it's not that easy to explain. This is really difficult. You have to discuss.
It is more with bars. I agree.
No, this. Well, you have so many parameters, and mostly the fiber rotation and the well, the link. I don't know how. Well, from a physical point of view, it is not that easy. Maybe from model, you have some interesting model in the cardiac mechanics. Maybe you can have more information about this. This is not a simple port because you have twisting. You have at the same time you have a shortening, twisting, and dilation. So this is not contraction. This is not that easy. So I don't know the link, the real link. But in a pump, in general, you have, of course, you have a strong link between the mechanics of the pump and the pressure difference. But for the heart, the link between all these parameters, for me, is not that easy.
Well, what you say is, I think it's related to a rate of deformation. That's the most logical.
Okay, yes,
pressure gradient comes from a rate of deformation.
Yes, yes.
Which is the best rate of deformation to take into the heart? I think that's another discussion.
Okay. Okay, so this is well, this is the first this is the first study, and then we have to do some prospective study in hypertension. And well, this is my next next slide. at least we saw that for one center, we saw that the peak intraventricular pressure difference can be routinely estimated by color mode. And then, this is our processes, it could help to better assess the diastolic function. So now, of course, this one was not first a clinical study. It was a pilot study comparing two parameters, and we're not sure about this parameter. But now, so we are now, the next step is this one. We are currently doing a clinical study. So this is a prospective study, and we have more than 300 to 400 patients, hypertensive patients, and we compare this parameter with the biomarker of the diastolic function, which is the NT-proBNP. So this is still a study under progress. It was longer than I expected. I have some time. Yes? Okay, you have a question?
Yeah, just quick, the biomarker.
Yes. Well, this is a classical biomarker. I won't say. You have to discuss with clinician about this.
Because the
There is some biomarker. This is a marker of the for heart failure normally.
Because the question was you monitor two parameters.
Yes.
Which one is the one that is used clinically to assess diastolic dysfunction? We don't know yet.
You have several parameters. But this is like sometimes you have some contradiction between the different parameters. In this study, everything has been measured normally. You have strain rate, I don't think so, because this is not depending on the center. This is not a routine practice. So the what was used, this is the A prime, so some ratio, the standard parameter. There's also the biomarker. Of course, in this patient, we have some follow-up. So.
Because you correlate your new parameter
with another one,
and not with
exactly.
diastolic dysfunction,
exactly.
which is also
exactly. So that's why we have to do something more clinical.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And to avoid this kind of question from the reviewer.
There will be another question.
I don't know if I had a. I was supposed to talk about this. This is the gastric vortex now. It is another application of CardioDoppler, but now using the full map of CardioDoppler. And this is how to characterize the diastolic vortex. So during the filling, first you have a strong rate, then we talk about this, you have the formation of a large vortex. Here this is why it is a representation. So you can see the formation of a large vortex just after the beginning of the filling. You will have a vortex forming in the left ventricle and rotating in this, the normal one rotating in this direction. And why it has been said that this diastolic vortex, it ensures the flow transition to ejection because you have a natural rotation. So from the mitral leaflet here, you have natural rotation, which can help systole, the ejection. So you can see from this vortex, we can see that systole is coupled with diastolic filling. And it is supposed to minimize the fluid energy dissipation, I mean in the normal vortex, and so to optimize the efficiency of the cardiac pump. So it has been said that the vortex patterns could be also some determinant factors for the heart function. And for this reason, many investigators work on this vortex formation. There are two ways to measure if you want the vortex, you need the vector flow imaging. You don't need only CardioDoppler, you don't need only one component. You need at least two components or three components if you're working with a 3D ultrasound. but this is difficult. So a way to have the vector flow imaging in the left ventricle, this is using MRI. Magnetic resonance imaging. You have here a nice example. You can see the vortex formation by the vortex. And also eco-PIV. Eco-PIV, this is contrast echocardiography. You inject some contrast agents in the left ventricle so that you can have some strong speckles here. Because normally the signal from the blood is very weak. So to increase the blood signal, you can inject bubbles. And then you can see you have speckles here. And then using techniques like speckle tracking, we see that later. So you can track the speckles and then have the velocity vector field. But it's difficult to use MRI. MRI actually in practice, it's almost impossible. Every day. And also eco-PIV is feasible, but you need more staff. It's time-consuming. So the question was, is it possible to use conventional Doppler echo to extract some the velocity vector field and then to use some vortex flow imaging? So here there are two examples. So how to do that? Remember that with CardioDoppler. So this is a series of scan lines. And for each scan line, we have only the projection of the actual velocity along the scan lines. Okay, so a Doppler, if the actual velocities are this one, the black arrows like this, so we have only the projection. Of course, if the flow is parallel to the beam axis, we have all the information like this. But imagine the case of when it is perpendicular, you don't have anything. So you remember that CardioDoppler is only one component. So if you look at the typical image here of CardioDoppler in the patient, this represents actually this. Okay, you only have the component along the beam axis. So this is equivalent. But it's not enough to extract the vortex here. So from this information, is it possible to extract the other one? So we want the cross beam direction, the information across the beam, this one. Well, actually, this is what I will explain here. Using the technique called vector flow mapping, from this information, there is a way to estimate the other component. So how to do that? First, there is an assumption. This is on the plane of investigation. We neglect the out-of-plane component. And then if we use the mass conservation, so that means that if we are in 2D, the divergence of the velocity is zero. Here, the divergence in polar coordinates. In phased array, we can work in the polar coordinate system like this. And the Doppler will mostly give the component around the radial direction. So let's say that we know more or less the radial components, Vr, and we want to estimate the angular component, V theta. And using the divergence, if the divergence is zero, or is assumed to be zero, or almost zero, using this equation, since we have all the information about the Vr, so we can extract V theta if we know some boundary condition. So boundary condition could be extracted, for example, so the velocity at the boundary using speckle tracking, or we can use other assumptions. In our case, we assume that the flow is almost parallel to the endocardium, to the boundary. We made some validation with MRI, using 2D MRI or 3D MRI. Here, this is an example of 3D MRI. You can see, of course, the vortex is not in 2D. This is here you have the 3D vortex. This is a vortex ring at the very beginning of the early filling. And from this using vector flow mapping, so we can have some observation. I will show you an example later. Here, this is at the beginning of the filling. So you have a vortex formation at the close to the mitral leaflets, and then you will see that it will develop. And sometimes in some patients, you will have an abnormal vortex close to the apex, like this one. So we saw that with the vortex patterns, we saw some differences from one patient to another. Here you have some examples. In a normal patient, the vortex is very large, like this. And for example, here it was a patient with a mild hypertrophy. You can still see the normal vortex, of course, is this one. And then an abnormal one close to the apex. And in case of severe hypertrophy, you can see that the flow, well, from the streamline, you can see that the flow is highly disturbed. And this is a movie. It was the original movie from the G scanner. And then by extracting the data and then using this technique, we can have the representation of the velocity vector field on the right. So we can see the vortex formation.
What was the frame rate?
Well, the frame rate, remember, for CardioDoppler. So the question was, what was the frame rate? So it is a main issue here. We typically have 8, 10 frames per second. So to obtain this high frame rate, we have to do an acquisition for at least five cardiac cycles, and then we made some temporal registration by ECG triggering. Of course, this technique should be applied to ultrafast card Doppler to remove this problem. And it is interesting because this technique is now on the Hitachi scanner. Our first publication was it was 6 years ago, and then they implemented this algorithm this algorithm in some scanner like this one. You can have some example in YouTube, for example, or in their website. And since it is available, many clinicians try it, and there are more and more clinical paper about this. Now I think there is more than 200 clinical paper. Including a recent one in JACC. So it seems that vortex imaging has some interest for clinicians. But again, there is no study about reproducibility, no real prospective clinical study, so this is at the very beginning. And because Hitachi used my own algorithm in their machine, I wanted to develop another one. So I don't know if you want to know more about this. I know the problem with the first algorithm. So of course, it is implemented in the Hitachi scanner. So there's a way to do it better, and probably to do it for 3D as well. So, this picture is interesting because here are the raw data that we use. So this is before scan conversion. So you can see that this is not like this, like a sector, but this is we have scan line by scan line. In this case, we have N scan lines, and typically is around 30 to 40, and we have a number of samples for along each scan line. And using this, so using another algorithm, so this is now we use an automatic L2 regularization. We can extract the, again, what is more or less the same topic, the same algorithm, but it was improved. We can also extract the vector flow mapping. You like equation, right? You said yesterday that you like equation. So I put some equation. basically, this is where we want to minimize the functional. We know VR, remember? Well, VR. No, we know VD. VD are the Doppler velocity. And we said that VR and VD are almost similar. So in the functional, we see the functional that we want to minimize. So we tell that here, this is a fitting to the Doppler data. I don't know if you are familiar with that regularization. Maybe I should skip this one. But the most important information is that we still have the divergence here. Okay, this is a mass conservation. We want this to be close to zero. Not zero, but close to zero. Here, this is some boundary conditions. And here, this is some smoothness constraint. We want a smooth velocity field at the final. This one is under review. It's not soon under review. It is really under review. What is nice with this, it looks complicated like this. But actually, this is just a matrix system that can be solved in less than 1 second in my computer. So like this. Now you have, at the final, you only have a matrix, a sparse matrix. So you have a lot of zeros. So you don't need a lot of memory to extract the parameter. At the entrance, of course, you have the Doppler velocity. And then you want at the output the radial velocity and the angular velocities. And here, this is what we can obtain with this algorithm. This is a clinical example. You can see here the beginning of the fitting. So you can have you can see the fitting, and then the vortex formation. In Y, this is a criterion to detect the vortex, and. This is only the normal vortex here. I'm showing only the normal vortex, so the one rotating in the clockwise direction. Here you have the vortex formation, diastasis. Diastasis is the between the A wave and A wave. This is where you can have the large vortex. And then atrial systole. Atrial systole, this is when the atrium contract. So you have the formation of a second jet here. And you can still see the vortex. And then still you have rotation and then systole. Here are other examples. While here you can see a normal, some abnormal vortices close to the apex. Here it is normal one. Here this is almost a normal subject, so it's a strong vortex. And another application here. So you can see here the color represent the color Doppler. But with this approach, so you can see a nice overview, you can have a nice overview of the velocity in the left ventricle. And well, we hope that it will be available soon. We try to develop an algorithm for that. And I wanted to compare. It was published in a recent paper in the European Heart Journal. And of course, I made some comparison with my algorithm. So I hope that the new algorithm will give better result than the old one. Something that we have to check. Yes?
You told that there
out about reproducibility and
about this? Not yet.
Isn't it a bit too early then for Hitachi? Why do they integrate it already in the system if there's no?
Why? Because it's as a research tool, huh?
Okay.
So, first at the beginning for strain imaging, it was as a research tool. It's still as a research tool for strain imaging. Some clinicians doing some research, they can use it to improve the diagnosis. But strain imaging, for example, is not really in the guidelines. We saw that there is something, but they're not sure about the threshold value. For strain imaging, mostly this is what we call the global longitudinal strain. So now it's more or less accepted. But it was available, so the clinicians were able to see there is some interest for this parameter. And this is even for vortex, for vortices. The tool is available in the ETH scanner, so clinicians try it for research investigation tool. And so that it could be an interesting parameter for that function as well. So I think it's time to propose new tools, better tools, and check the reproducibility of this technique. Exactly.
Clinicians might base a diagnosis on this
data. I don't know. We should have the point of view from a clinician about this, because I don't know when you have a research tool, if it's biased. I'm not sure. Maybe
this is in a way a balance of forces. Eh? So you have at the one hand the companies that have to find tools in order to promote their products, the clinicians that need new tools to make publications,
exactly.
And so, and in the other hand, it's like you would assume that clinicians are not totally stupid, which means that they just use this for research, and they normally will never ever base a clinical decision on one parameter.
Exactly.
At least they look at the patients.
And they want their first
in Europe, at least they do. But
well, same.
You showed before an MRI image where you see the. Could you make a validation of this technique?
Yes, this is
compared to that one.
We made this for the first algorithm, and this is what we want to do with this one, using 2D MRI to get another comparison. The problem is that MRI, we said that this is the gold standard. This is, but not really, because mostly 2D MRI. There is a tendency of underestimation because the spatial resolution is not good, temporal resolution is not good is not good. You have some kind of smoothing. Of course, we have to compare to something else. It will be MRI. MRI 2D or 3D, we don't know yet, but we have to be careful. MRI, 3D MRI is not really the gold standard.
At least you can coerce in your simulation and your
but this
example
is
to...
This paper, we compare with the simulation. So from the 3D, remember the 3D simulation? So we simulated the Doppler, color Doppler. We simulated then we used this algorithm, and we had some kind of validations. But it is only one case, and it is a normal heart. So we have to compare this technique with MRI in normal subject and in patients. So it will be probably a long study. Maybe 20 patients will be, at least 10 patients, 10 subjects will be good, at least.
In the first part of the talk, you used the Doppler to quantify diastolic dysfunction. Here you are augmenting the data from Doppler. Can you use this augmentation to get a better diastolic dysfunction?
Yeah, this
quantifier
is the objective, yes. Actually, you cannot assess diastolic function with one single parameter. It's impossible. That's too... We try to find the parameter, whatever, the systole, diastole, but no, this is an overview. The clinician from his experience and from the measure, he can have a nice overview of the problem. And of course, he doesn't want hundreds of parameters. So there is a compromise between the number of good parameters and the decision.
Have more information than just
since we have more
nine. So maybe
we expect this in theory to be better than the previous one, but the problem with this one probably the reproducibility will be much lower. So even if theoretically we have more information, maybe in the clinical practice it won't be as easy as I am saying, because you have a lot of parameters that can change they can change the lowest parameter, the output parameters.
I think this is a really, really interesting discussion, eh? Because the question is here, what clinicians say is we want one parameter that tells it all. It's like, that's what they would like.
Yes, but...
You see everywhere this doesn't work. On the other hand, I think as researchers, as engineering researchers, we should try also towards a goal, which in the end would be more important, and that is try to get an integrated representation of the heart, from which then later on you can extract whichever parameter you want. And I think this kind of important. This will not provide the answer because this is the flow. The answer is in the combination of the flow and the tissue,
exactly.
And really get the interaction because one will behave differently as the other, but having a whole representation, I think that's the important part. So rather than saying like, okay, we make this as a new parameter for diastolic function or whatever, this is a way to get more information of the heart. We need this at some point in 3D. We need 3D strain with that. Of course, we're not there yet, but I think we have to put this in our mind that this is the goal. We need to go to a full representations of the fluid and the mechanics of the heart because that, in the end, is the only thing that will provide the answer. Yes.
And this is a good point because this is one of our investigation in our lab using ultra-fast ultrasound. We are able to have at the same time a nice beam mode, tissue Doppler, and the color Doppler in one cycle. So this is what we try to develop in our lab using ultra fast echocardiography. And then from this, probably we can find some interaction between or some link between tissue and of course it's something that we are investigating.
Also for validation with 3D MRI, you have another component. So here you take 2D component and you have theta and the R.
Yes.
And you have also another component.
Yeah, which is here, it is assumed to be negligible in this case. Huh? This is 2D. So yes. This is a strong assumption. We assume that it is negligible. Not zero, but negligible.
So why is it negligible? Is there...
Why? There is no particular reason. Huh? But...
I think it's quite a good assumption because the mitral valve and the aortic valve are in one plane, which means that the biggest change is there. In the other direction, obviously, there will be a component, but the main component will be in the plane of the mitral aortic valve, and that's what you look at in view. So,
good response.
So. Could you just explain more about the cost function, why you can put this in
about the cost function,
and how can you adjust the lambda? And
can we discuss about this later? Or
okay.
No, it's a good point. Here, when you have a cost function, you have many parameters. So it could be you could say, wow, how to adjust? You have lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, but there are some techniques to do that automatically. We use the L hypercurve. So we could discuss about it later. But if you want a software, it has to be if you want to have a software for the clinics, since you want something very reproducible or at least very very reproducible, you need something. We don't need to smooth, but to adjust to fine tune the parameter. So that's why we want our algorithm are all almost automatic, almost fully automatic. So lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, this is not dependent on the operator. This is automatic. Because this is a very important point, because you can have very different results depending if you fine-tune the parameter. And in a lot of paper in engineering, like in TMI, you have a lot of function like this, and they're more or less justified than lambda 1 and lambda 2 and lambda 3. But if you don't have something automatic from a normal subject to a patient, it will be very different. And that's why we use something fully automatic. The problem here is the segmentation. But we demonstrate that the effect of segmentation, of course, from one condition to the next one, segmentation could be different. And so we showed that the segmentation has a minor effect on the final results. This is the mass conservation. The mass conservation is here.
Yes.
First, you have to fit, of course, with the data that you have, but this is mostly this part. we want divergence is zero, or is small. That means that the flow on this plane is two-dimensional and incompressible. Incompressible is okay. This is a two-dimensional the problem. But for this view, it is acceptable. This is a three-chamber view, and on this view, this is more than acceptable. And with this approach, we could it's something that we will try to 3D. We're going to try a 3D algorithm, and we see. In 3D, we don't have the problem about divergence. But we have in 3D the problem is we only have one component, and you want to extract two other components. So we have some. We need more assumption. Okay. Well. You're chairman, huh? 10 more minutes, because I just want to. Here, this is we have a tool, but now. Why this tool? This is another way to improve dastry dysfunction. And if we have a dastry dysfunction, it means that the left ventricular filling is impaired. You have a problem. So that means that the kinetic energy at the inlet is reduced, and probably the vortex energy is reduced. So we assume that if we have some dastry dysfunction, probably the size of the vortex will be smaller. Something that we check in patients. So how to do that? So from Doppler echo, we have the vector flow mapping. So Doppler echo, this is the red blue color. From vector flow mapping, so you have the map. Using this map, you can extract many parameters. For example, here it was the streamlines. So in the black lines are the streamlines, and then you can have many parameters. But we extract some kind of size of the vortex. Here it would be, for example, on the size of the vortex. And we estimated the relative size of the vortex relative to the size of the left ventricle. And we explained that the vortex left ventricular area ratio as the maximal area of the vortex divided by the area of the left ventricle multiplied by 100. So for example, in a normal subject, you have a large vortex like this. And here, this is a severe cardiomyopathy. The vortex is smaller. So this is, and we check this in hypertensive patients. So all the patients here were normal according to the standard echocardiographic parameter. So E prime, the ratio E prime on A on A, every parameter were normal in this subject. But one group were hypertensive or pre-hypertensive. So we know that hypertension is a risk factor for dastry dysfunction. So probably with this this patient will develop dastry dysfunction. And we wanted to check if this vortex is an early marker for dastry dysfunction. So this is why we selected this population, and we actually saw using this algorithm that the size of the vortices of the main vortex was lower in patients. Well, it's not still patient, but in subject with hypertension or prehypertension. Right, this study was performed only in the night 2 subjects, but we still saw some significant differences. I remember that the other parameter we didn't see any difference. So maybe it is a clue about this the size of the vortex. Of course, this is still under investigation. So, this is the conclusion of this part. Again, we think that it could be another parameter for dastry dysfunction. I wanted to finish with something because we hold. I think this is important. It was an editorial in the JACC Imaging, JACC Cardiovascular Imaging, and I think that every people in engineering working on medical imaging should read this editorial. Because it talks about the different steps in clinical imaging. It begins with a simple idea, or a case report. Often it is a case report for clinicians, and for us this is some hypothetical idea. And then, of course, we go into the technical development and validation. And mostly we stop at this level. But you can see that if you want to have some impact in patients, you still have three major steps. And this one is not that easy. You need a large multicenter study to check reproducibility. And then as soon as you show that the tool that you developed has some reproducibility, you have to prove that it can have some impact in patients. Is it useful for clinicians? And then, of course, if it is the case, you can change ideas, so you can change some of the guidelines and the consensus. And if we have a look at this, IVFM is only at this level. So technical development and validation, and still it's very beginning. Elastography, now you have some multi-center study, but we still don't know the impact on the patient. We have an idea, but it's in between. Strain imaging, now we know that it can impact diagnosis in patients, but still the guidelines, we were not sure about the threshold. And of course, color Doppler, when it was developed, it has been developed a long time ago, so we had to go from there. And now color Doppler, of course, is used every day in clinics, so color Doppler is at the last level. So this is, I think it was very important. Well, I would like to thank my colleagues. This is my office in Montreal. I would like to thank my students. Here, Jonathan is here. So Jonathan worked on ultra-fast color Doppler and ultra-fast echocardiography. I still have a student, Julia Fleury, who is working on the link between tissue Doppler and color Doppler, and some other people, and also the cardiologist. Amir will be here tomorrow with his colleague Eric Salou, and cardiologist working with Eric Salou and François Tourneau, so Mathilde. And of course, I'd like to thank the CREATIS US team, represented here by Olivier, because I'm there as an innovative researcher. So thank you. This is a special day today. So happy Valentine's Day. And this is, you can see the vortex inside the left ventricle. I had to do that, I'm sorry. There's no copyright, so if you want to add this picture for your husband or wife. It was a question. Yes, yeah.
Would I summarize correctly from that last slide with Mount Fuji that it takes 40 to 50 years to go from the case report to
this
the
one?
Changing IDs? Yes.
Yes.
So 40 to 50 years to go from the bottom to the top.
I don't know. What do you think about strain imaging? Strain imaging,
well,
the first paper, including one of the first paper about strain imaging. You were very young at this time, I think.
Yeah, indeed.
So I don't know. It was...
No, 95.
How many years?
More than 20 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah, so you
Doppler
see...
Was,
and I think, 50, I don't know, so maybe... I think with your do you agree that we still on this level, and
yeah,
not?
Yes, absolutely.
Of course, we saw that strain imaging. We discussed about this in the next presentation. It has some impact in patients, but unfortunately, it cannot be used in the clinical routine because from one scanner or from one vendor to the next one. So you can use a GE, a Philips, a Siemens, or Hitachi. You can have different values. So this is one of the main problems. Even in the same patient, but depending on the post-processing, you can have different values. So this is one of the main problems about strain imaging. And so probably I don't know how to deal with that, but I think you organize some kind of meeting between different vendors for, I don't know how to...
We'll
discuss about this because it's very interesting.
In the next session, yeah.
Okay. Well.
And about the vortex imaging, so far it's been looked at quite often to try to assess the diastolic function.
Yes.
But wouldn't it be more logic to use it as a tool to look at valvular function?
To look at what?
Valvular function. Because I think the motion and the status of the valves is going to have a major impact on the vortex.
We have a problem about mitral stenosis because you have strong aliasing.
Yeah.
And of course there is some post-processing here because we have aliasing, but it is very easy to remove. In case of mitral stenosis, we have a problem. And now about the prolapse, probably. We did not try it, but probably. Mm. But we did not try.
Mm.
on this valve topic.
Yes.
There has been publication studying the effect, the shape, the morphology of the valve on the vortex.
Yes, exactly.
And showing like that if the valve is placed a little bit, you have two vortices.
Exactly.
So that might be.
This is something we never try because this is our beginning. For the moment, we are focused on the. On hypertensive patients for the acid dysfunction because it's easier to have a large population. And as soon as we have a software, it's something that we could share with colleagues working on this specific topic. I don't know the occurrence or prevalence of this kind of mitral disease. This is not this is not as common as hypertension, of course. So. But probably it would be very interesting, of course, to be for collaboration in this case.
But in some ways, I agree with Jan also. It's like, but on the other hand, you don't need to look only at diastole. Eh? Mm-hmm. If you have mitral regurgitation, your systolic kind of flow pattern will change also. And it might actually contribute to understanding it more.
Yes.
And on the other hand, also that you say is like, that for example, in hypertension, you might have less velocity or less vortex or whatever. Mm. It might be that it's increased. Eh? There's patients with very small heart. Mm-hmm. As soon as your left atrial pressure goes up, it might be that you have an increased vortex.
Yes.
So in that sense, it doesn't directly correlate with what we currently use as diastolic function.
Yeah, right.
So it's something which is much more complex. But the way I see it is I think it's very interesting to look at the flow patterns, but not to estimate, again, one parameter that they used to do, but to see, like, in different types of population, what's the added value or the information that you can extract on top of all the other information that's available, rather than instead of.
Yes, indeed. And while regarding your comment about, we assure the size, the relative size, and we saw that the size was lower in patients, but if you have a patient with dilation, with a dilated heart, you have a strong vortex. So this parameter won't work in this. Clearly, the size is dilated, there is a big problem. But according to my parameter, you have a normal size. So still, we don't know. We can have a nice visualization, but to quantify it, you can have the size, the vorticity, you can have many parameters. And we still don't know which parameter will be one of the best for this application. And probably the clinicians don't want 10 parameters from this application. One, maybe two. Otherwise, one from CT imaging, one from vortex flow imaging, one from tissue Doppler. Exactly. So we have to reduce the number of parameters. Yes.
Just a totally different question.
This isn't my fault if I'm late.
We're the organizers, so we can.
Oh, yeah, right.
Are you aware of any work learning, machine learning type on this type of vortices?
No. I think we discussed with Olivier. Olivier, for any reason, he likes machine learning. And probably, we can we could improve the process, but I'm really not familiar with machine learning. It's something I will learn through the work from CREATIS. And probably, yes, why not? I don't know. For me, it's not clear, machine learning, how it could improve this. I prefer equations, so I don't know.
To comment on that, there is a company in California, spin-off from Stanford. I forget the name, but I think it's called Artesis or something.
Yes.
And they do learning
on the flow?
Vortex flow, but not from echo, from CMR.
From CMR.
And they have a joint venture with
they want to
one regular, of the big companies.
This is kind of what they want for regularization? For what exactly?
For estimating the fluid dynamics and then getting parameters out. I'm not sure which parameters
okay,
they
spit
out.
Okay, you don't know what are the input parameters?
The input are the CMR images.
CMR,
yeah,
but
face
velocity.
Contrast. Yeah, face contrast. Yeah.
Okay, but probably so they have the phase, this is phase MRI, right?
Yeah.
So they already had the velocity information.
But you still need the entire fluid dynamics.
Yes.
It's only a couple of slices.
Okay,
Then extracting parameters out of it.
Ah, yes, okay.
And they have a joint venture with one of the main vendors so that all of the images from that vendor are automatically sent to them.
Okay. Okay, interesting. Yeah, so there's publication about this? No publication, nothing?
Yeah, and they have a website also.
Okay,
so
I didn't know. Okay.
I think it's called.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, thank you.
If there are no more questions,
thank
let's thank the speaker.
Okay, thank you for
attending.
innovation and you. Philips.